Wouldn't you like to know how to supercharge your brain and make yourself smarter and more radical than ever?
Yeah, me too. But the brain isn't just a car that you make go faster. Being smart and productive mean different things depending on what you're trying to do. There are literally hundreds of brain-boosting smart pills or nootropics that tinker with your brain chemistry to make you function better. So in this video, we'll talk about how to know which nootropics are more likely to work for you and your unique brain, the nootropics I've personally found effective, and why some nootropics are good or bad depending on what's on your to-do list. There are hundreds of things that could be considered nootropics, some safe and some risky. I've tried a lot of them, some worked, most of them didn't do anything, and the strangest one was methylene blue, a research chemical slash aquarium cleaner which gives me both mental and physical energy, but also makes my head hurt and turns my pee blue. But what's interesting is that while some nootropics didn't work for me, they did work for my friends. So why is it that modafinil literally makes me unable to procrastinate, but just gave my friend a massive headache? And why does this cocoa flavanol supplement give him a boost in focus, but just makes me nauseous? In his 2004 book, The Edge Effect, American physician Dr. Eric Braverman proposes that much of our personality, from whether we're anxious and uptight to how easily we motivate ourselves or how good we are at focusing, could be explained by different levels of neurotransmitters: dopamine, acetylcholine, GABA, and serotonin. Neurotransmitters are very complex and have many functions, but as a rule of thumb, dopamine keeps you excited and wanting to do things. It makes you motivated. Acetylcholine increases your processing speed and keeps you focused. GABA tones down excessive stimulation and lets you relax. And serotonin fosters positive mood and creativity. Everyone's favorite neurotransmitter is, of course, dopamine. Caffeine, Adderall, Ritalin, modafinil, and especially white nose powder all increase dopamine signaling.
Oh my god, what a drink!
However, my issue is apparently a lack of GABA. GABA is what allows you to relax. This made enough sense to me because I'm really good at finding things to be stressed out or anxious about. Like, for example, the fact that I still haven't finished this or that project, and I haven't even achieved all my life goals.
No, I don't deserve sugar. I haven't accomplished anything.
L-theanine is a nootropic that's been really effective for me. Its main effect is helping you relax without making you drowsy. It works in a couple ways, but it also seems to raise GABA. Studies have found it to improve mood and focus. When you hear smart pills or study drugs, you probably think of stimulants like Ritalin or Adderall that basically make you really alert. However, it's a lot easier for me to do the fluid thinking necessary for creative work when I'm relaxed. I often procrastinate on my writing if I'm too tensed up. I'm sure you've noticed yourself that great ideas come when you're relaxed, say taking a walk or a shower. Even if you've got great GABA signaling, unlike me, theanine may still be effective as it also increases dopamine and serotonin, and research has found better memory and attention in people who combined L-theanine with caffeine, rather than taking caffeine alone. So you'll get more out of your coffee if you pair it with theanine. Next up on the list of things that actually work for me are exogenous ketones. They may be the worst thing I've ever tasted, but I do get a short boost in mental energy and mood for about 45 minutes. Why it works is complex. I've talked in a couple videos about the brain benefits of ketones, but ketones have also been found to increase energy in dopamine neurons and allows the body to produce more GABA. Next up is, of all things, nicotine gum. I say gum specifically because I don't smoke cigarettes, which obviously do more harm than good. And by the way, it's all the other crap in cigarettes that actually gives you cancer, not nicotine. A primary reason smokers say they continue to smoke despite the consequences is to stay focused. On that note, rates of smoking are quite high in people with ADHD, and this paper specifically says that people who have difficulty staying focused may benefit from nicotine. Cigarettes just make me nauseous and give me a headache, but I find that when I chew nicotine gum, my mental chatter gets a little quieter, and it's easier for me to get in the zone and stay focused. There's a network of brain regions called the default mode network that is thought to be responsible for that annoying, nagging inner chatter. The restless inner voice distracting you from the present moment, saying, "Oh, I need to do this, I should have done that, and I think my boss hates me," etc., is associated with the default mode network. A couple lines of research has found that nicotine essentially quiets this default mode network, allowing you to literally get out of your own head, and it's been established that nicotine improves attention, vigilance, and working memory. Now, while this does improve my focus, I'm not really recommending it. Nicotine is addictive. I take the smallest amount necessary to feel an effect. About 1/6 of a 2 mg gum works for me. Now, nicotine acts on the cholinergic system in the brain. The main cholinergic neurotransmitter is acetylcholine, and it's important for attention, learning, and memory, among other things. Another cholinergic nootropic, Bacopa monnieri, is rumored to have been used by ancient Indian scholars to memorize long passages. I have a friend who suspects he may be low in acetylcholine signaling, and he struggled with a bit of ADHD. He wasn't quite satisfied with how quickly he made progress on his goals or to-do lists. So specifically using nootropics that target the cholinergic system worked really well for him. In specific, it was a combination of alpha-GPC, phosphatidylserine, and ginkgo biloba. Personally, I didn't really feel anything from phosphatidylserine and alpha-GPC. This could be because my results from the earlier questionnaire suggest I might already have strong acetylcholine signaling. Huperzine, which is found in Joe Rogan's Alpha Brain, is another popular cholinergic nootropic. But I've tried huperzine a couple times and it didn't really do anything for me. Now, despite my supposedly great acetylcholine signaling, to be honest, I don't consider myself to be a naturally diligent person. I used to have terrible procrastination and couldn't stay on task for more than 20 minutes at a time. So we can't just pin whether someone is diligent or not on one neurotransmitter. Now, despite being another cholinergic, about 125 milligrams of ginkgo biloba liquid extract gives me a noticeable boost in motivation and energy for about an hour. As a nootropic, it has many effects. Just to name a few, it raises dopamine, it increases blood flow to the brain, and it seems to be generally protective for brain cells. Next up is aniracetam, which raises serotonin and is one of the most famous nootropics for boosting creativity. Looking at a 2019 review in the journal Frontiers in Neural Circuits, it seems that serotonin may have a role in bolstering creativity. Baba Shiv of Stanford University says specifically the state of high serotonin and high dopamine are great for creativity. On that note, the mind-blowing entheogens like acid or mushrooms have led to creative insights for many people, and they have a very strong effect on serotonin receptors. Now, I haven't tried any racetams as they're illegal in Japan, but as mentioned before, I do find it easier to do creative work when I'm taking L-theanine. That could be because it relaxes me, but it could also be because it raises both dopamine and serotonin. Serotonin also appears to reduce connectivity in the default mode network, that monkey mind part of the brain. Now, before you go out and buy all these nootropics that allegedly boost serotonin, you may want to just think about diet. Nutrients like zinc, magnesium, vitamin B6, selenium, the amino acid tryptophan, and fish oil all support serotonin production. Speaking of vitamins, have you noticed that many products claiming to wake you up and make you more focused have a crap ton of B vitamins? For example, Monster Energy Drink has vitamin B3, B6, and B12. These B vitamins are very important for the nervous system, and they're all involved in energy production and the production of neurotransmitters. A deficiency in any of these will lead to neurological conditions. In fact, B12 is involved in the biosynthesis of all four of the neurotransmitters we talked about: acetylcholine, dopamine, GABA, and serotonin. And in a study from the year 2000, data from 3,000 people found that at least 2 out of 5 people on a normal diet are somewhat deficient in vitamin B12. Maybe you've even seen that there's a ridiculous amount of B12 in certain products. 5-Hour Energy has 8,333% the daily value. This is simply because the more B12 you consume, the less efficiently it's absorbed. For example, I would absorb just over half of the 1 microgram of B12 in 50 grams of beef, but I'd only absorb 2% of the 500 micrograms of B12 in 5-Hour Energy. So maybe if you're low on energy, you should just make sure your diet is plentiful in all the right vitamins instead of drinking blue aquarium cleaner. A while back, I was reading this book by nootropics aficionado Ryan Ballow, where he talks about all kinds of nootropics I've never heard of, like uridine monophosphate, theacrine, and vinpocetine. Interestingly, the nutrients iodine and selenium were also on his list of nootropics. This totally made sense to me because they are two nutrients that are very important for your thyroid gland, which, if isn't functioning properly, can really tank your energy levels and make you gain weight easily. In fact, a study in Italy investigated the children born to women in either a region with enough or not enough iodine. And ADHD was diagnosed in 11 out of 16 of the low iodine children, but in 0 of the iodine sufficient children. And total IQ score was nearly 20 points lower in the area without enough iodine. Iodine is found in a lot of foods like seafood, dairy, eggs, and of course, iodized salt. So the point is, before you go online and buy a bunch of random pills, it's worth considering that simply targeting nutrition could be more effective, not to mention cheaper, than nootropics. For example, if you suspect you need more acetylcholine signaling, rather than going straight to buying a bottle of alpha GPC, you may benefit enough from simply eating more choline-rich foods like meat, eggs, or shiitake mushrooms, especially egg yolks and liver. But if you still want a brain boost, at least have some rules of thumb before you buy a bunch of bottles of pills. For example, for me, it was helpful to take a look at what neurotransmitters I might be lacking in and which ones I may already have enough of. Based on that earlier questionnaire, my dopamine seems to be fine, and the nootropic dopamucuna, which mainly raises dopamine, just makes me feel hot and ill. However, it works great for my friend who scored low on dopamine. Also, think about what your goals are first. Do you need to be more creative, or do you need to do your taxes? If it's creative work, you'll probably want to avoid nootropics that mostly raise norepinephrine, as this seems to actually hamper creativity. But it does make you more alert, attentive, and improves your working memory. But let's say you have a job interview coming up. In that case, you'll want to take a nootropic that enhances language processing, something like paracetam, so you don't trip over your words. But if you really want to land your dream tech job, you'll want to check out Keras.io. Whether you're preparing for a sales or engineering role, you'll want one-on-one help from an expert who can polish your resume, prepare you for the interview, and coach you on salary negotiation. Keras has tons of vetted interview coaches who are actually from Google, Facebook, Amazon, Spotify, Tesla, Apple, and more, helping hundreds of people land jobs at tech companies. So if you want to double your chances of getting that offer, check the link below for $20 off your first coaching session at keras.io.